He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. Broken and poured out all for love.
Welcome to worship from Capel St. Mary Methodist Church. Today we start a new series, Jesus Unrecognized, and we welcome Rod Stone as our speaker. The next few weeks will see us having shorter services, but we will still be gathering together afterwards by using the Zoom link that's at the bottom of the screen. Let's pray. Lord, we come for guidance for our journey, your word for our minds, and the power of the Spirit to give us life. We have come to you, Lord, because you are the way, the truth, and the life. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
reading this morning comes from Luke chapter 24 and verses 13 to 35. On the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he was going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread.
It's great to be joining with you this morning, though it feels still somewhat surreal to have to do so online. Our reading this morning from Luke 24 focuses on the afternoon and early evening of the Sunday following the Friday when Jesus was crucified. Two guys are walking from Jerusalem to a village called Emmaus. It's a distance, we're told, of about 7 miles. Jesus, who's risen from the dead earlier that same day, comes and walks along with them. We're not told how far they've progressed on the journey when Jesus joins them, but they've probably not gone far because the ensuing conversation is obviously lengthy. I just want us to consider very briefly four questions raised by this incident. The first question is, who are these people? We're only supplied with two scraps of information about them. First, we're told they're Jesus' disciples. And secondly, that one of them's called Cleopas. The other one's not named. Some have suggested it's likely to have been Cleopas's wife. They were just a couple of ordinary disciples, not high profile, not celebrities. Ordinary disciples like all of us gathered here today who are Christians. These are guys with whom we can identify and from whose experiences we can therefore learn. Second question, shouldn't they have recognised Jesus more quickly? two reasons immediately spring to mind as to why you'd have thought so. First, he'd told his disciples many times that he'd rise from the dead. Matthew 16, verse 21 tells us from the time of the incident that Matthew's just described, which is where Jesus acknowledges that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, and Jesus has said, on this rock I'll build my church. From that time onwards, progressively over a period of time, it says, Jesus began to explain clearly to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed on the third, and on the third day raised to life. Matthew later gives two specific examples of Jesus telling his disciples about the resurrection. The first in chapter 17, verse 22, and a very detailed one in Matthew 20, verse 1. Matthew, Mark and Luke also give very explicit instances of Jesus preparing his disciples for his death and letting them know that resurrection would follow. And John does too, but less explicitly. So why had these two guys not made a mental note of something as mega as that? Now Jesus has been crucified and they've realized that this is the third day after that. Why are they not expecting, actively looking out for Jesus to show up? Okay, that they weren't part of his innermost circle, but it's surely inconceivable that they'd somehow missed all the occasions Jesus had talked about rising from the dead. But somehow they'd not understood. They'd no expectancy for Jesus to reappear. Sadly, it was true of all the disciples, even those who'd been there on every occasion that Jesus had talked about this. How often do we fail to understand and remember things that God has said to us? Particularly things that we find hard to take, that stretch our credulity. But whilst this explains why these guys are not expecting Jesus to show up, how come they don't recognise him when he does, especially when they'd heard reliable witness reports that very day that Jesus had been seen alive in the morning? In verse 22, they say, some women from our group were at his tomb early this morning and they came back with an amazing report. They said his body was missing and they'd seen angels who told them Jesus is alive. Some of our men ran out to the tomb to check and found it just as the women had said, but they didn't see Jesus. This happening on the third day after Jesus' death, you'd have thought that might just have jogged their memory, brought back what Jesus had so repeatedly said, but it didn't. Which raises the third question. Why did they not recognize him? Verse 16 tells us they were kept from recognizing him. Does that imply demonic involvement of some kind? Maybe. For sure, we have spiritual enemies who delight in preventing us from recognizing and enjoying the presence of Jesus. 2 Corinthians 4:4 talks about the God of this world blinding the minds of those who don't believe so they can't see. But what kept these two from recognizing Jesus may simply have been that he looked or seemed different. There's no suggestion he was in disguise, sporting a balaclava, shades and a false beard. But maybe his resurrection body looked different in some way. Maybe his voice had altered. This may have been a factor. That morning, Mary Magdalene had not recognised him at first, but for her, recognition had quickly dawned. With these guys, the failure to recognise him continued throughout a 7-mile walk, or the best part of it. Maybe it was grief that blinded them. Verse 17 tells us that when Jesus first approached, they stopped short with sadness written across their faces, looking sad and gloomy, long-faced, like they'd lost their best friend. Grief undoubtedly contributed, and it seems they were trying to handle it by turning the whole thing over in their minds rather than reaching out to God, forgetting the assurance in Deuteronomy 4:7 that uniquely among the religions of this earth, our God is near to us whenever we call on him. And the very specific promise in Psalm 34:18 that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. If anyone here today is grappling with grief and struggling to find God in it all, I'd encourage you to reach out to him, placing faith in these promises, to ask him to make you tangibly aware of the closeness that he's promised. Disappointment, disillusionment, despair were clearly also major factors contributing to these guys failing to recognize Jesus. We had hoped, they said in verse 21, that Jesus was the Messiah, the one who'd set Israel free. It seems like all their hopes had been dashed, that the dreams had died. That's devastating in itself. And all this is compounded still further by bewilderment. This had been an issue for Mary Magdalene that morning too. Already overwhelmed with grief, she'd had to process two bewildering encounters, one after the other in quick succession. First, she came face to face with an empty tomb, denying her the opportunity to carry out the plan on which she's intent, to honour his dead body. Then she's confronted by a couple of angels and she's so preoccupied she hardly seems to notice them, doesn't answer them any questions. So it's hardly surprising she doesn't immediately recognise Jesus when he appears a few minutes later. But as we've said, with Mary, recognition quickly dawned. These two guys walking to Emmaus are also bewildered. The events surrounding Jesus' death had happened so quickly and for them, unexpectedly. Now these reports of angelic visions and sightings of Jesus have lied. Maybe it's simply a question that they're too busy to notice. You know, how often we'd do well to realise that it's good to talk less, to pray, to listen to God more. Verse 15 tells us they were deep in conversation, going over all these things that had happened, talking and discussing them together. In verse 17, on joining them, Jesus first asked them, what are you discussing so intently as you walk along? They're obviously logical, analytical types. They feel the need to try and understand what's been going on here. And their approach, their response to the situation contrasts sharply with that of Mary Magdalene. With her that morning, the heart, the emotions seem to have predominated over the mind, over the need to understand. And isn't that just how it is? You know, some of us tend towards more emotional responses to situations, others to more reasoned responses. We seldom respond with heart and mind in perfect balance. But the message of these two stories is that Jesus loves people at both ends of this spectrum and everyone in between. He's there for us, patient with us, however we're wired mentally and emotionally. but there are problems with responses based mainly on how I feel about it, and equally so with those based on how I think about it. Jesus refers these two guys back to the Bible. That's what he does straight off, to what God thinks, to how God feels, because the root problem here is that these guys have not paid attention to what Jesus has said, to what God said. They've not understood, they've not believed, and that is the bottom line to their failure to recognize Jesus, unbelief. Jesus says to them in verse 25, "How foolish you are, how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Why can't you simply believe what they said? Wasn't it clearly predicted that Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory?" And those are Old Testament prophecies he's reminding them of. He doesn't even mention his own recent and repeated spelling out of what was going to happen. The root cause for non-recognition for these two, for all the first disciples, and actually very often for us too, is quite simply a failure to believe God's word. Which brings us to the fourth and final question that is thrown up by this incident. What finally did bring recognition? It's interesting and very significant that at no point here does Jesus simply say, "Come on, listen, don't you recognize this voice? Take a good look, can't you see? It's me, I'm Jesus." He doesn't draw their attention to his physical presence. Why not, do you think? Well, surely because he knows that subsequent generations of his followers won't be able to know him that way. He opens the eyes of these disciples to recognize him, to know him for who he is, in a way that can happen for anyone in subsequent history, including us today. Recognition here comes in three stages. First, through getting into the Bible. Here, obviously, meaning the Old Testament, as the New Testament hasn't been written yet. Verse 27 says, "Jesus then explained to them everything written about himself in the scriptures, beginning with the law of Moses and the books of the prophets." And as he speaks to them, the scriptures start to come to life like never before for them. It brings light into the darkness that's upon them. Later in verse 32, after Jesus has left them, they realize their hearts were burning within them as he talked with them on the road and as he opened the scriptures to them. Recognition had begun to dawn right there, but they're not there yet. A second stage comes through them wanting more. Verse 28 says that as the two approached the village to which they were going, Jesus seemed to be going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening, day's almost over." So he went home with them. They're liking this. There's something about this guy. They want to stay in his presence longer, even though they've still not realised who he is. If they'd not been eager for more, he'd have just gone on his way, and they would never have recognised him, never have known that they'd been with the risen Jesus that afternoon. Psalm 107 verse 9 tells us that God satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. You know, these guys were thirsty and hungry for more. Jesus had whetted their appetites for more. In Luke 1:53, Jesus says that something very similar, that God satisfies the hungry with good things, but he sends the rich, he says, sends the rich those who've had enough. He sends them away empty. Really getting into God's word with illumination from Jesus, in our case, from the Holy Spirit, makes us hungry for more, hungry to experience what's promised. It's an enduring key to discovering God's presence. Thirdly, and finally, for these guys, recognition comes through breaking of bread. That's what clinches it for them. When Jesus broke bread and gave thanks, the focus at that moment was on his hands. Maybe they glimpsed the nail prints. Maybe the way he did it recalled the way he'd broken the bread that fed the 5,000. We're not told exactly what did it, but somehow at that moment, as he broke the bread, they knew it was him. And he disappeared. Job done. Neither of these two disciples were present at the Last Supper, as Jesus took the bread, gave thanks and broke it and shared it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The church had not yet been born. Communion was not yet an established practice. So the three here were not sharing communion together as such. But what happens here surely for us evokes memories of Jesus' words at the Last Supper. He's told us to remember him in a manner just like this. And when he tells us to do something a particular way, he always has reasons for that. With communion, one of those reasons is clearly that he meets us in a special way every time we do it. It's a means of grace through which he reveals himself to us afresh, brings fresh recognition. And many of us will have experienced the reality of that. It's certainly not the case that in order to recognize Jesus for who he is, to experience his presence, our experience needs to mirror exactly that of these two disciples. These three steps are not a blueprint for coming to recognition of him, but there are keys here for entering into relationship with Jesus or rediscovering him if we've somehow drifted away. There is no substitute for getting into understanding and believing his word as the Holy Spirit comes and illuminates it to us, for reaching out to him hungry and thirsty for his presence. And communion is a very good way for Christians to keep the connection with him fresh or to reconnect with him. As we close, let me present a challenge to you. For a whole afternoon, these guys were in the company of the risen Jesus, but were oblivious of it, unaware it was him. And they could easily have never known, never realized. And for them, he was physically present. How much more easily can we miss him when he's right there with us? Fail to recognize his presence because we can't see him physically. We can only apprehend spiritually. And he comes to us in ways that we don't expect. I'll never forget hearing the story of an elderly Welsh lady who'd been praying for years for revival. In 1905, she heard it had come to her local church. So she went to check it out. What she saw was people laughing and dancing, weeping and prostrate on the floor. She thought to herself, this is chaos. She closed her heart. She left and never returned. And she spent the rest of her life lamenting the fact that she'd missed the Welsh revival, that which she'd longed for so long, because it didn't look like she expected it to. She missed, to use the words Jesus spoke over the crowd on Palm Sunday, she missed the time of her visitation, the time of her nation's visitation. In the parable of the sheep and goats in Matthew 25, Jesus says that on judgment day, many will ask, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And Jesus would reply, Jesus will reply, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. And there's a dire warning to those who do nothing for such people. Let's determine that we'll not miss Jesus because he comes to us in ways we don't expect. But let's be prepared, eagerly on the lookout for him in every situation. And equally, let's not miss the enjoyment of his presence through taking it for granted, through just assuming he's there because he said he would be, and pretty much ignoring him, save when we particularly need something. He's looking for relationship. Let's pull out all the stops to make him welcome in our lives and in our homes, to host well the Holy Spirit. What a tragedy when a church like that in Laodicea, which thought it was doing pretty well, is in reality keeping Jesus outside the door knocking, in danger of having its lampstand, the very presence of God in their midst, removed from them. How is it with your church? Would you actually notice if Jesus wasn't there, if he'd left? Would it just go on pretty much as usual? Come on. The risen Jesus was there for these two individuals on the road to Emmaus at this dark time for them. And he's here for us today. We can meet with him right now, wherever we're at. Obviously not physically, but with equal reality through the Holy Spirit. As we reach out to him in faith, we can know him today, filling us with new hope, with fresh wisdom, with renewed vision. And like these guys, we'll just be longing to share the experience. Our reading ended with them returning immediately to Jerusalem and sharing with the 11 how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, that you've done everything necessary to enable us to enjoy an ongoing experience of the reality of your presence in our lives by your Holy Spirit. I pray, Father, that you'll pour out your Holy Spirit afresh upon these lovely people in Capel, gathered together online right now. May no one fail to experience and recognize your presence, Lord. In Jesus' name, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May he smile upon you and be gracious to you. May he show you his favor and grant you his peace. Amen.
Waking and sleeping, thy presence, my where countless saints have walked before and triumphed by your grace, your faithfulness, their victory song, their joyful voice agree. There is no better way to walk, for Jesus walks with me. There is no better way to walk, for Jesus walks.